the understanding of the new covenant, people live a deprived life. Do you understand? When you do not understand the new covenant, you are living a life that is deprived of the privileges and of the blessings of that new covenant. So let's go quickly to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we started out the last session, we were talking about this covenant meal. Alright? This covenant meal, and we stopped there, and we're going to continue from verse 26. And try to give you an understanding, because the scriptures that we're going to read this morning, and I'm going to give you some, I've got a bit of an outline here, so that I can stay on track to give you an understanding and develop in your mind a thought pattern. It's important to get a thought pattern, you know, and I'm going to try to do that. So I've got myself an outline to help you. So from this verse onwards, right up until the verse 34, can you just cut this mic down a bit? Yeah, that's fine. Right up to verse 34, from verse 26 to verse 34, there's been a misunderstanding about that verses of Scripture. So the moment you talk about communion, people are afraid. You see, people sometimes would not partake of communion because they say that their lives are not right. And they're not right. You know, their lives are not right. They're struggling with some kind of a problem or some kind of addiction or something that is not right in their lives. So they say, you know, my life is not right, so I can't partake of this. Now, that is a trick of the enemy. We're going to understand these verses of Scripture today. It's important for you to know the truth. That's not the truth. If all of us can put ourselves right, right? Then why did Jesus die? Why did he have to die? Why did he have to shed his blood? Why did he have to give himself as a sacrifice for us if we can clean ourselves? But we did look at the old covenant. And we realized nobody could clean themselves. And the old covenant wasn't good enough. So that is why we're studying the new covenant. The Bible says the new covenant is a better covenant. It's a covenant of rest. Are you listening? So we get this legalistic, preachers come along and bombard the people and condemn the people and make them feel that they are not worthy enough to partake of this table. But you know what? If a person does not partake of this covenant meal, there's consequences. Not good ones. We're going to look at that quickly. Let's just go quickly. Let's start reading the verses of Scripture. And as I'm reading them, just break up there and then just share with you a few points that I've written down. I just want to keep this, I want to keep it in order, because I want to develop in you a mindset. You understand? So that is why I'm going to do it in this way. So verse 26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Alright? The big question there is, who do you proclaim his death to? World? To the world? To your neighbors? To your friends? No. You are proclaiming the Lord's death to yourself. Are you listening? You are proclaiming it to yourself. In other words, you are accepting what Jesus Christ has done for you. You are proclaiming this to yourself. The word proclamation is like the word declaration. You understand? It has the same impact. So when you partake of this table, you are declaring that Jesus Christ is your Lord. And you receive everything he has done for you. Imagine that. Imagine when somebody does not partake of this and inside of themselves they feel condemned and say, you know, I'm not good enough to partake of the table. When are they going to ever make that kind of declaration? Is there anywhere else in Scripture? Is there anything else they can do in church? Is there another ordinance in the body of Christ that they can use to make the declaration? No. This is the only ordinance. Are you listening? Word you declare. In other words, you for those that are stable in their faith, and they have received and accepted everything Jesus Christ has done for them, and even as they continue proclaiming it or declaring it, they grow from grace to grace, from strength to strength. Are you listening? And the weak is made strong. Did you get that? I said the weak. How can the weak person strengthen himself or herself if they are denied of such a privilege? Come on, church. Can you see the work of the devil yet? Can you see the trick of the enemy? And some of these preachers are illiterate. Sorry to say that. They have not given them the time and the energy to study the scriptures. I'm still a student of God's word. I still study. How much of studying can a person do? I don't know. I think I'll be studying for the rest of my life, as long as I'm here on the earth. Because the word of God is so deep. I can't come to a point and say, no, I have achieved now. You know, I've got my degree now, and I've got my diploma now, I've been to college now, and then come to a point of, you know, stagnant. No. The scriptures are alive. The word of God is alive. I'm going to have to continue and keep studying. Because I can't stand before you, keep giving to you stale food. You understand? We're going to come with fresh revelation and fresh understanding of the word of truth in order for you to grow. So now imagine if somebody walks into this room and they say to themselves, I'm not good enough to partake of that table. So in other words, that person is weak and is going to remain, or she's going to remain weak for the rest of her life. Do you see that? How they are denied of the privileges and of the blessings of God. So let's move on. Verse 27. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and of the blood of the Lord. Now, that is one of those verses of scripture. Alright? That is one of the verses of scripture that is intimidating. Are you listening? Because of the misunderstanding of unworthy manner. So, in other words, you have to be perfect. If I have to interpret the verse of scripture like that legalistic preachers, then I will say that everybody has to be perfect. Can we? In our own strength? No. But we are perfect. Are we? Yes. How have we become perfect? By His blood? By His broken body? Are you listening? So listen. Let's just interpret this quickly to you. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, not themselves unworthy, whoever partakes of this covenant table and makes that unworthy. In other words, take the worth and the value out of it. Not you, the table. Make the body and the blood of Jesus Christ seem unworthy, unfruitful. You know, just like another religious ritual. That scripture is not saying that you have to be perfect, but the scripture is saying that you cannot treat that and make it unworthy. Are you listening? Because if you have truthfully come to this table with your witness, you'll be made strong. Why? Because you place worth on the blood and on the body. You're drawing strength. Not from the preacher, not from you, yourself, or from anyone else. You're drawing strength from the covenant meal. Now listen, when a person avoids that table, when a person avoids communion, they are weakening their covenant relationship with God. It's such a serious thing. It's such a serious offense. For you to yourself, that is, not to God, to you. When you deny yourself of the privilege of making that declaration, you're weakening your covenant relationship that you have with God. But that covenant meal strengthens that covenant relationship. So, unworthy manner is not you. Unworthy manner to that table, making it worthless. Seems, you know, as if there's nothing about it. You see people doing that all the time. You understand? They do not place the emphasis that that table requires and that act of faith requires. They don't. It's just a religious thing now. That is why it's just taken so haphazardly. And that's out of ignorance of the word of truth. Nobody's benefiting anything from it. So let's go on quickly. There's a few verses we need to deal with. But let a man examine himself. Right? Let him examine himself. And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Can you read that? He's not saying let a person examine themselves and take a walk. Take a hike, you know. They're not good enough for the table. Is that what the verse is saying? No. It's saying let a man or a woman examine themselves. What does it mean to examine yourself? What does it mean? If I have to examine myself, I'm going to ask myself some serious questions, right? So what is the first question I'm going to ask myself? Who am I? I know it's a philosophical question, but you're going to have to ask that question once in your life at least. So if I'm going to examine myself, I'm going to ask myself a serious question. Who am I? Who am I before God? And the next question I'm going to ask myself is, who is Jesus Christ to me? Can you see how personalized this is? And there's no religion in this. No. This intimacy, this fellowship. That's why we call it communion meal. This communion. This communication between me and Jesus. So the first question, who am I in the big picture of things before God? Who is Jesus Christ to me? Now, you know what will happen to me? By the time I get the answers to those two questions inside of me, you know what I'll be doing to myself? I will be repositioning myself. Every person that examines themselves repositions themselves. And when you are repositioned, when you have repositioned yourself, you are powerful. Then you look at this, not unworthily. You look at the power behind this. You understand? You realize that you are in covenant with Him and who you are the righteousness. Who am I? I am the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ to me? My Lord and my Savior, the Lamb of God, through whose blood I've been cleansed and have been ransomed. By the time I come through with those thoughts, after examining myself, I'm repositioned. Repositioning yourself is such a powerful thing in the Lord. Alright, so then where it starts? It starts in the mind, okay? Examining yourself starts in the mind. Let's continue. Next verse, please. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner. See? Can you see that again? For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Alright? So in other words, you come to this table and you just take it for granted, you know, and you just partake of it without being conscious, firstly, of who you are, being conscious of who Jesus Christ is, repositioning yourself in your mind, preparing your mind, and partaking of this by faith, believing that this bread is His body and this juice is His blood. Can you see the connection there? Or you can do what the scriptures say. You just walk over to the table, take a piece of bread and take the juice and say, thank you, Jesus, and have it. That's an unworthy manner. Are you listening? So in other words, you're taking the impact of it away and you're treating this as if it has no worth to you. So you're not going to get any benefit from that. The benefit comes from when you position yourself and when you take this. I'm not saying that you must become religious. I'm saying that you must have reverence in your heart and be serious about this matter, because this is a covenant meal. As we're digging into this, please stay with me as close as you can, because this is going to, this teaching, by the time I come to the conclusion, is going to blow you out of the water because of your not understanding what the new covenant is. All right, so, for he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner, eats and drinks judgment to himself. In other words, you have not examined yourself, and you are bringing judgment on yourself. Because why? You're not discerning. You're not discerning the Lord's body. You're taking partaking of this religiously. You don't know the impact behind it, how behind it. And then you bring in judgment. In other words, you're condemning yourself. And Christians do this often all over the world. All over the world. I watch people when they take communion, even on the television. I watch this and I get frustrated. Because they keep relating to this as emblems. You know, they keep relating to it as emblems, as elements and all kinds of things, which the Bible is not saying. Jesus said, when he broke the bread, he didn't say he ate this bread. He says, no, this is my body. Who said that? Jesus. And then when he gave them the cup to drink, he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. He didn't say these are emblems, these are types. No, this is the real thing. So we come with the same heart, and we are conscious of this, and we have positioned our hearts and our minds, we have repositioned ourselves, because we want the full impact of what this table can bring to us. Let's move on, please. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Quite frightening, right? So this is another misunderstood verse of scripture. Let me ask you a question. Why are the people weak and sick among you, and many sleep? The word sleep means die. Why? Because of this table? So what is the lies the enemy spreads? It is because of this table. They went and partook of the communion, you know, their lives are not right. And they went and partook, that's why they got sick. This is a covenant meal. This brings healing. This doesn't bring weakness, it brings strength. This doesn't bring death, it brings life. To who? To dead people. It brings strength to weak people. It brings healing to sick people. This deal. But religious spirits have taken this verse of scripture, and intimidated the people of God and pushed them away from this. So the scripture says, for this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. What reason? The reason for the people being weak and sick and dying is because they don't know that this is a covenant meal, and there's power in this action of faith. So when we take this bread in our hands, we say, Lord Jesus, this is your body broken for me. See, that's the proper way of doing it. And when you take the cup, you say, Lord, I thank you for this cup. For this cup is the cup of the new covenant in your blood. I thank you for your blood. And we partake. That's now coming into the truth, into the word of truth. There's no sickness can stay in your body when you do that with faith like that. There's no weakness can remain in you. Even if death is knocking on your door, he leaves you. You remember we looked at where this originated from in the last session? You remember the blood of that animal they killed, and they put the blood on the doorposts? When the spirit of death came past, when he saw the blood, it went past? If the blood of the animals can do that, imagine the blood of Jesus Christ, church. Come. Imagine the blood of Jesus. Those people have so much of faith in the blood of the animal they killed that night. What about you and I? So why the church of God, the children of God, are walking around like a bunch of dummies? When they're so reliant on the systems of this world for their health, for their strength, for doctors to save them from sickness and disease so that they can live, when we have the real thing in our midst. No, this thing doesn't cause weakness. This doesn't cause sickness. And this doesn't bring death. This brings life. It brings healing and it brings strength. The more we push people away from this, the more people we are killing. And I blame those religious preachers for that. Week after week, they condemn the people of God. And yet the Bible says in Romans 8, there is therefore now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. They might be weak, but they can be made strong. They might be sick, but they receive healing. They might be at a point of death, but they'll be alive. Are you with me here this morning?
Yeah.
It seems like all of you left and you went to your home and you're in bed. I don't know if you could just do the teaching or what. All right, so see, this is a misunderstood verse of scripture. This does not bring death. It does not bring weakness. It does not bring sickness. This is strength. Man, every time we do this, we declare his death and what he did. And who he is. So he said, when you do this, you do it in remembrance of me. Because that's what covenant is. You do it in remembrance of me. You do it in remembrance of me. It's like you're going, you know, to the shop to buy something. And then you see something in the shop that your children like. Or you see something in the shop that your spouse likes. And you say, hey, this is nice. She'd love this, or he'd love this. And then you buy it. Why? Because you are in covenant relationship with your children and with your spouse. And you bought this. Not to go home and get some favor from them. You bought it for them because you love them. Are you listening? So you bought it in remembrance of them. So that's why Jesus said, whenever you come together to do this, do it in remembrance of me. Are you with me?
Yes.
Let's move on, please. Thanks, verses 2. For we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. This word is another intimidating word. Alright? This word judgment here is not like judgment to be condemned. In other words, the same word, examine yourself. So if you examine yourself, but it doesn't stop there, as far as judgment is concerned. If you examine yourself and you find that weakness or whatever it is, what do you do? What do you do? You discipline yourself. Everyone say discipline.
Discipline.
Because if you discipline yourself, then you'll not be disciplined. You don't need anyone to discipline. Are you following me?
Yeah.
So in other words, you need to take responsibility for your action. You understand? If there's something on your mind that is bothering you, if there's something on your mind that is holding you back, there's something in your mind that is hindering you from going to the table of the Lord, then you need to take responsibility for that thing.
Yes.
Are you listening? That is what it means. So if you take responsibility for that thing, then nobody's going to judge you. Are you listening? So if you are a disciplined individual, you take responsibility for it, God wouldn't even judge you. That's what it means. Verse 32. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord. The word chastened means we are disciplined by the Lord. You understand? Now let me ask you a question. Today, at this time in the new covenant, how does the Lord judge us? How will he chasten us? Or how will he discipline us? Because that's the meaning of the word chasten. How will God discipline us? You want to know? He do that through conviction. God does this through conviction. The Holy Spirit is the spirit of conviction. So if you are walking in the opposite direction, he's not going to leave you alone. He's going to tell you. He's going to nudge you. He's going to use somebody to come and speak to you. But one way or the other, You're going to get that message. Are you listening? And that is not because the Lord doesn't love you. No, this is what the scripture says. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. You understand? We may not be, we might not fall in the same trap that the world has fallen into. So you see, Father God, He loves me, He loves you. He has to correct me, if you have to chasten me, if you have to discipline me, if you have to convict me, He's going to do that. You know why? Because He loves me. He loves me. And that, at the end of the day, that's what it all boils down to. Next verse, please. Therefore, my brother, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. So this, not so much of a instruction to us, but it was more of an instruction to the church in Corinth, because the church in Corinth were a little bit hazard in what they were doing, and when it was time for them to come around the table of the Lord, you know, they were just, people were not even in churches yet, so they were just partaking, and the pastor of the church reported to Paul the apostle, and then he sent this letter of discipline to them. First Corinthians is a letter of discipline to the church in Corinth and to all of us. So, saying to them, guys, get your act in order. Alright? Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. You understand? Care for one another. Let everyone come together and do it with the same mind. That is why we've been doing this week after week. I believe that this is saving our lives. I believe that this is giving us strength and making us stronger. I believe that this thing is healing our bodies. I believe that it's giving us life. Are you listening? So that is why we do it in the way that we are doing it right now. Let's go quickly to Hebrews chapter 10. From the NLT. Alright. Now this is now coming into the new covenant, right? This is important for you to know. The old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow. We spoke about the shadow, right? So in other words, the old covenant that was given through Moses, the laws of the old covenant was only a shadow. How many of you know the shadow is not the real thing? Alright? So the old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow. A dim preview of the good things to come. Not the good things themselves. Are you getting that so far? So whatever the laws came through Moses regarding the old covenant, it was only a shadow. It was a dim preview of the good things to come, not the good things themselves. The sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year, but they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. Can you see the old covenant now? That is basically the picture of the old covenant. Let's see the next verse, please. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped because it would have been good enough. For the worshippers would have been purified once for all, and their feelings of good would have disappeared. Now we know in the old covenant that was not possible. Alright? Because it was only a shadow. It was a dim preview of the good things that were to come. Let's read the next verse. This verses will kind of clarify themselves as we read, okay? But instead, those sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year. You understand? So those sacrifices and those rituals they had to perform every year was a reminder of how sinful they were. How wretched, how blind, how naked, how poor they were. That's what it did. Next verse, please. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. How do you like that? I mean, that clarifies everything for us. So you see, the blood of the animals in the old covenant was not good enough. It was not possible for the blood of bulls and goats, the blood of the sheep of the old covenant, it was not possible to take away sins. So what did he do then? He definitely did something, because God tolerated that old nation for another year. He definitely did something. What did he do? He covered their sins. So the blood of the animals covered the sins, but the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses. What he does?
Yes.
He cleanses. So only the blood of Jesus Christ can take away sins. Say this after me. I am washed,
By the blood
of the Lamb of God.
I am cleansed.
I am renewed.
I am strengthened
by the blood of the Lamb of God. See, we live in two different places, church. When you go to the old covenant, it's a different place in God, and the new covenant is a different place. What privileges and blessings they had there and what now? Two different. This is better. Let's move on. Well, next verse. That is why when Christ came into the world, he said to God, "You did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings, but you have given me a body to offer." So in other words, what Jesus is saying, he says, for a season of time, you tolerated the blood of the animals. You tolerated the animal sacrifice and the sin offerings and the burnt offerings for a season. But now, you no longer desire sacrifices and sin offerings. Why? Because you gave me a body. See, in heaven, before Jesus came to the earth, he never had a physical body. Why? Because he was in the spirit. But when God gave him a body and sent him to the earth as a baby, he came with a physical body. This is what he's saying. He says, you no longer desire the sacrifices of animals, the blood of animals, the burnt offerings of animals. No. But you have given me a body to offer. So now the replacement for all of those animals was the body of Jesus Christ. The replacement for the blood of those animals was the blood of Jesus Christ. Are you getting this? Let's look at the next verse, please. You were not pleased with burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Can you see that? God wasn't entirely pleased. That's why I told you that he just tolerated it for a season. When the fullness of time came, God sent forth Jesus Christ at the right appointed time. Are you listening? So, but he was not pleased. He just tolerated that for that season, for those generations. Because he knew at the appointed time, he's going to send Jesus Christ, and he is the real thing. Say this after me. Say, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, is the real thing. He's not the shadow, right? He's the real thing. Okay, final verse 7. Then I said, look, I have come to do your will, O God, as is written about me in the scriptures. So he says, you gave me a body, you sent me here to the earth as a baby, and here I am. Every scripture that was spoken about me, every prophecy that was prophesied about me, every song that was sung about me in the Psalms, I've come to fulfill all of that. I've come to do your will. So that day in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was praying and agonizing there, and his blood vessels on his brow burst, in all of that agony, he said, Father, if it is possible for you to take this cup from me, but you know what? I came to do your will. Let your will be done. And then what he did, under that agonizing experience that he was going through, he submitted to God 100%. To become the Lamb of God. Are you listening? Now, just in closing, I want to remind you of this. Remember David? My favorite character in the Old Covenant. There's some things about that man, really, astonishingly, every single day, it astonishes me. You know, when he came to that war, the day when his brothers were in the battle, and they were on one side of the mountain, and, you know, the others were on the other side, the enemies were on the other side of the mountain in the middle of the two mountains, you know, there was a valley. And then David came with the food to his brothers, and then he heard this Goliath, you know, screaming out threats, threatening the Israelite people. And he was up there, a little boy, you know, I don't know what's his age, 14, 15, 17, I don't know, something around there, but he was not old enough to shave just yet. But you know, he was a warrior. He had experience as a teenager that none of those soldiers had. Okay, they had experiences. They were properly trained soldiers. They were trained as soldiers. They were trained as warriors. But David never got their training. David's training came from something else. Where did it come from? David's training came firstly from understanding what? Covenant. That's where his training came from. And you know what David believed? David believed that if he set his heart and his mind on doing anything, he will never fail. So, when he was inquiring who's this guy, the first question he asked those people, his brothers, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? You know that question? Already passed the death sentence for Goliath. In other words, Goliath was already dead. Goliath was a dead man walking. Already finished. Just by the words that came out of David's mouth, he already killed Goliath. By just saying it. Forget about the battle. Goliath was already dead. Why am I saying this? Because in David's understanding, I am in covenant with God, and he is not. He is not in covenant. That's what he meant when he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? In other words, who is this person that is not in covenant with God, but I am? Already the death sentence was passed. This man was dead already. There's no way David is going to fail in what he's going to do now. That guy was already dead. Believe me, that Goliath was a walking dead man. Where did it start? It started in the mind of David. Because he understood that he was in a covenant relationship with God. And nothing in this world is going to stop him to bring down that Goliath. That is why he said to the king, whenever a bear came, I went after it. Whenever a lion came, I went after it. I went and caught it by its beard, and I broke its jaw, and I rescued the sheep, king. Oh, David, how can a small little boy like you do such big things? Because I'm in covenant. And in the same way he said to the king, I'm taking down the Goliath. He's going to die today. In fact, he's already dead. Because I'm in a better position in the sight of God than he is. You know, when I was just in the office last night, and just meditating on this thing, and I said to the Lord, I said, Lord, if only our people, man, it put so much of sorrow in my heart. I tell you, I was so sad. You know what? Because when I look at you, when I look at the church and I see how out of sync you are with this truth, I see you living just like the worldly people. I see you doing the same things as they are doing. I see that you're living a deprived life as good as they are living. I see that you are trusting in the arms of flesh like they are trusting. I see you putting your hope on the doctors and on the politicians just like they are doing. Man, you know how sad this is. But here's a young man who understood that he was in covenant with God and he can never fail. When he gets down to that, he's going to end what he just said. When he gets down to the valley, he's going to do what he just said, because that Goliath is already there in David's eyes. This is what I'm trying to bring to you today. You are recipients of the new covenant, but yet you live as if you have no covenant. Yet you live as if you belong to your bloodline, you belong to your parents, you belong to your forefathers, you belong to South Africa, you belong to the politicians, you belong. When are you going to see yourself for who you are? When are you going to look at yourself for the mirror of God's word to find out who you really are? When? Because there's no difference between you and the worldly people. You operate with the same mind. You your job in the same way. You buy and sell in the same way. You do your shopping in the same way. You're just like the rest of them. You don't have the superior mentality that you're supposed to have, because you don't know that you are in this covenant with God and you are head and shoulder above anyone else. David was the youngest in the camp. He was the smallest. Everybody was taller than him. But spiritually speaking, David was taller than everyone else there, because he was in covenant. Can you see that? I have a very big burden in my heart. A serious one. I'm not going to rest until I see the body of Christ come into sync with this truth and start living out the privileges. Living out the blessing, living out the privileges. Some of you got too much of faith in yourself because you keep listening to this thing on television, on YouTube, wherever. Believe in yourself. Believe in yourself. Believe in yourself. Believe in yourself. What an abomination that is. How about believing in the one who saved you? The one who cut the covenant for you? The one who left his body and his blood for us? How about believing in him? He has made you the head and not the tail. You didn't make yourself. Can you sense that burning? Can you stand with me, please?